Now, I want to read this evening, though most of our scriptures going to be on the screen, I want to turn to the second chapter of the book of Daniel, and I would like to begin reading at the 28th verse, and I'm reading tonight from the American Standard Version. American Standard Version is not the Revised Version. This is the very scholarly translation made at the turn of the century. Now, I want to read this, and will you listen to the language as I read? It is Daniel in the presence of Nebuchadnezzar. But there is a God in heaven that revealeth secrets, and he hath made known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what shall be in the latter days. Thy dream and the visions of thy head upon thy bed are these. As for thee, O king, thy thoughts came into thy mind upon thy bed, what should come to pass hereafter. And he that revealeth secrets hath made known to thee what shall come to pass. But as for me, this secret is not revealed to me for any wisdom that I have more than any living, but to the intent that the interpretation may be made known to the king, and that thou mayest know the thoughts of thy heart. Now listen to this language. Thou, O king, sawest, and behold, a great image. This image, which was mighty, and whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee, and the aspect thereof was terrible. As for this image, its head was of fine gold, its breasts and its arms of silver, its belly and its thighs of brass, its legs of iron, its feet part of iron and part of clay. Thou sawest, tell that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon its feet that were of iron and clay, and brake them in pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold broken in pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away, so that no place was found for them, and the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. Now, that is the dream that Nebuchadnezzar had. And the background of this dream was this great king, as he meditated at night upon the fact that he had been elevated to world empire. He wondered what the future held of that empire, because there had been nothing like it upon the earth. And so this king, with that thought in mind, went to sleep, and God gave him this tremendous dream, a dream of an image. And the picture there would imply that he was puzzled, trying to think just what it was. He didn't say, as our translation has it, "The thing is gone from me." But as the American Standard Version has it in note form, "the word is gone forth from me." He knew what his dream was. He just wasn't telling these boys that were getting free meals at his table. He felt that they had been fooling him. And he said, "If you are genuine, you will tell me the dream." He knew what the dream was. He said, "The word's gone forth from me, and you're either going to have to tell it, or you will be put to death." And it was the thing, of course, that sent this man Daniel on his face before Almighty God. Now, God had spoken to Nebuchadnezzar in the kind of language he understood. He showed him an image. And by the way, these are votive figures here from the Neo-Sumerian period right before Nebuchadnezzar. And Babylon was the fountainhead of idolatry. These are in the British Museum and reveal something of how Babylon was given over to idolatry. No city or no nation was ever so given to idolatry as these people were. So God spoke to him in a language he understood, an image. He could understand that. And that's the reason God gave him that. Later on, when God spoke to Daniel and went over the same ground, he gave him different figures altogether, and they were figures of wild, carnivorous animals. And those animals reveal not the outward splendor of the kingdoms, which the image does, but reveal the nature of these kingdoms. Now, he was told, Daniel was, that when he went on his face before God, that God would give him the interpretation. So Daniel went before Nebuchadnezzar, and he told him, he says, that when you dreamed, as we read tonight, this is what you saw in your dream. You saw this image, and this image covers a certain area of human history. It covers a period, by the way, that shall be known as the times of the Gentiles. He was told he would be shown what things are what shall come to pass hereafter. This man had been wondering about the future of his kingdom, and now God speaks to him and tells him what the future of his kingdom is to be and what is to come after it. Now, somebody says, you say it's the times of the Gentiles. Where did you pick that up? Well, the Lord Jesus, when he sat over Jerusalem, wept for this city. And he made this statement, Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. When the Lord Jesus said that, yonder outside the walls of that city, at that very moment, Roman legions were marching through that land. Gentiles were trotting down Jerusalem. And that began, my beloved, at the destruction of Jerusalem at 606 B.C. when Nebuchadnezzar first took this city. Wasn't until 587 that he burnt the city and he destroyed the temple and actually scattered the ashes out over the countryside because of the rebellion. From that day down to the very present hour has been the times of the Gentiles. Now, this image covers the times of the Gentiles. It begins with Babylon. Nebuchadnezzar was called the head of gold. I'm not tonight dealing with that at all. Medo-Persia, the second, and that was the second world empire. After that, the Greco-Macedonian Empire under Alexander the Great that was divided under four kings. And then there came the fourth kingdom. And that fourth kingdom, it's interesting to note, is a kingdom that will concern us tonight. And more attention is given to that than anything else. Now, the interesting thing is that this image that Nebuchadnezzar saw, we are told it was mighty. That means the size of it was tremendous. It also says that it was bright, the brightness of it. It speaks of its color. The sheen of it was glorious. And then it was terrible. That is, it was awe-inspiring. It was impressive and terrifying. For it set forth in outward splendor and glory the times of the Gentiles from Nebuchadnezzar down to this very hour in which we live, my beloved. And the story of the Gentiles may have an outward splendor, and it does, but it's the most sordid history you've ever read. Now, I do not care, I never did care much for Mr. H.L. Mencken. He said some very harsh and ugly things about Christianity. But he also made some very pertinent statements about other matters. Here is what he has said concerning governments. He said, government is actually the worst failure of civilized man. There has never been a really good one. And even those that are most tolerable are arbitrary, cruel, grasping, and unintelligent. Indeed, it would not be far wrong to describe the best as the common enemy of all decent men. That's H.L. Mencken. And may I say that when you read the story of Gentile world history, you almost agree with him at that particular point. Now, the first three kingdoms there are tonight historical. They come in under the field of history. And there is a general agreement tonight among all conservative scholars, regardless of their school of prophetic interpretation, that these three kingdoms are Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greco-Macedonia. And the only ones that would disagree with that are the liberals, and their trouble's not with the image of Daniel. Their trouble is with inspiration. And therefore, I'm not interested in dealing with them at all tonight. What I'm concerned about is this fourth kingdom. And I'd have you notice it, because this fourth kingdom is the one that for us tonight is eschatological. That means it's still in the future. Part of it's in the past, history, as we shall see. But part of it projects itself into the future. We are living now, right tonight, during the time of the fourth kingdom. And I would have you note, my friend, there's not a fifth kingdom there. Now, for years, when I first entered the ministry, I always spoke of the toes and the feet as not as a fifth kingdom, but sort of a fifth kingdom. Rome disappears, and then Rome comes back. That's not the picture in Daniel. I'm convinced tonight that we have an answer to the enemies of premillennialism. And may I say that my study, again, of the book of Daniel, and I've been reading several very fine new books, scholarly books that really are terrific. And I'm more convinced of the pre-tribulation, premillennial view of the Scripture than I ever have been in my life. I'm convinced that's the correct interpretation of the Word of God. Now, this fourth kingdom is the one that concerns us. It reaches into the future. And Daniel said to Nebuchadnezzar that this image tells you what's going to happen in the latter days. Now, that expression, latter days, is an important expression in the Word of God. Because, my friend, it's used again and again. The first time it occurs is over in the 49th chapter of Genesis, verse 1, when Jacob brought around him his 12 sons, and he began by saying, I want to tell you what's going to happen in the latter days. Now, somebody says, but that only reached down to the time when the tribes would come into the land. True. But you'll notice that every time the expression latter days is used, it will begin at a point that's close to the one who uses it, but it always reaches down to the coming of the Messiah to establish His kingdom. That to me was one of the most amazing things when I began to check on that this time, my beloved. It always points to the coming of the Messiah. It reaches, my friend, to the end of human history, to man's sad and sordid story of attempting to rule this universe. Now we want to dwell tonight on this fourth kingdom, and that fourth kingdom is the Roman Empire. And the interesting thing is that there's more details given here and in the vision of Daniel about the beast concerning the fourth kingdom than the other three put together. And that's strange, because the fourth kingdom was the one that was not in existence at all in Daniel's day. The first one was, and the other one came into existence during his lifetime. And there's some that think, and of course Greece was yonder in the city-state form, but was not a world empire. But Rome was not even in existence at all. Now, Rome succeeded Greece in a chronological order, and may I say that that's a matter of history. And as soon as the great empire broke up of Alexander, that went through a period there of over a century, when there was bickering and fighting among the generals of Alexander the Great. And then yonder in the west arose a new kingdom. That kingdom was Rome. That kingdom, my friend, has been different than all other kingdoms that's ever been on this earth. And may I say to you that I trust tonight that we can let you see that not only with the pictures, but with the Word of God that we can put on the screen tonight. To begin with, this empire covered more territory than any empire ever covered before it, and will you hear me, or any empire since then. This was and has been the only truly world empire in the history of this world. It made the Mediterranean Sea, they called it in Rome, Mare Nostrum, our sea, our little pond. And believe me, my friend, that's what they made it. I read now in the second chapter of Daniel, the 40th verse, and the fourth kingdom shall be strong as iron. For as much as iron breaketh in pieces and subdueth all things, and as iron that breaketh all these shall it break in pieces and bruise. Now this is this fourth kingdom of iron, and it's the strongest one of all. This verse of Scripture, it is from our authorized version. And that word bruise in the new translation, when I say new, I mean this American Standard Version, is translated crush. It's the strongest Hebrew word you could get. This fourth kingdom, it shall break in pieces and crush. Now, will you hold that in mind? For that's a picture of Imperial Rome, the strongest kingdom of them all. That's the picture of this kingdom that filled the earth. And the thing that marked it out was the Roman hoplite. You see him there as they have a prisoner. That Roman hoplite became the badge of the Roman Empire. He was the infantryman. He didn't have too much uniform. He could move speedily. He had a short sword. And his picture became the sign of Rome over the greatest extent of territory and over millions of people. It was the sign of the power of Rome. And if you want to know something of this kingdom, I want to read you what one of the Roman historians wrote, Dionysius. Will you listen to him? He says, if anyone considering the governments of which we have any account in the past apart and is compared with one another, would judge which had the largest rule and wrought the brightest deeds in peace and war, he will find the Roman far to surpass all before it, not only in the greatness of its empire and the splendor of its deeds, but in its duration until now. For the Assyrian Empire of fabulous antiquity held but a small part of Asia. The Median, which destroyed the Assyrian and gained a wider rule, lasted no longer time, but was overthrown in its fourth generation. And then dropping down, he makes this statement, but the city of Rome rules the columns of Hercules, but the ocean too, as far as the ships may venture. It first and alone of all, in all recorded time, made east and west bounds of its sway, and the period of its might is not brief, but such as no other city or kingdom ever had. Since it subdued Macedonia, which at that time seemed the most mighty on earth, it has now for seven generations, even in the time of Dionysius, he could say for seven generations, ruled without rival, barbarian or Greek. No nation, so to speak, disputes her supremacy or declines to obey her. Now, Dionysius sounds like the Chamber of Commerce of Rome as he writes this. But may I say, the interesting thing is that what he's writing and saying happens to be the truth. That was the Roman Empire, my beloved. Now we are told that iron breaketh in pieces and it crushes. And that's the way Rome came to power. And this kingdom, my beloved, was ruthless and brutal as they put down all opposition. You're looking now at the ruins of Carthage. And those of you who studied ancient history, remember that when Hamilcar, the great general and king of Carthage, took his son down to the water's edge yonder in North Africa and looked across and said to him, to Hannibal, he said, son, over thy lies Rome. And every day I'm going to tell you to hate Rome. And that boy hated Rome. Hannibal was one of the greatest generals the world has ever seen. That man took an army up through Italy. He had elephants in his army. Came down through the Alps and sacked the city of Rome. You would have thought Rome would have been destroyed and would have ended. Any other nation would have ended. God said they wouldn't. And Rome rose out of the ashes. And Rome went over to avenge herself. And Rome again. It was that great, eloquent Roman who stood yonder in the Senate every day and concluded every speech by answering Hamilcar by saying, Carthage must be destroyed. They destroyed it. Yonder's the wrecks and ruins that they left, and they still stand yonder today to awe the tourists. The greatness and grandeur of this kingdom. God says, Rome's like iron. It'll crush. My beloved, that's their story, and you can follow them anywhere. And in the vision that Daniel had of the beast, he said, thus, he said, the fourth beast, and the fourth beast is the same as the fourth kingdom, the legs of iron. The fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon the earth, which shall be diverse from all kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, and shall tread it down, and break it in pieces. My beloved, that's Rome's story, and it's a matter of history tonight. This is not guesswork we're dealing with this evening. We're not leaping into the dark. We're merely telling you what's history. But when that was given, Rome was not even in existence, my beloved, at all. Now I want you to notice how this nation went ruthless and how it went in its brutality over the face of the earth with a scorched earth policy that brought every tribe and nation, the barbarians in the north and civilized North Africa, and the glory of Greece and the religion of Palestine and the Orient under its sway and rulership and under its law. And the chariots of Rome rode, my beloved. And I tell you, they brought the world under the sway of Rome. I want to take you on a little tour here that'll give you some idea of how this great kingdom got started and how it moved out yonder. Because they made the Mediterranean Sea, they made it Mare Nostrum, their little sea, and they were looking out for other worlds to conquer. This is a picture of Porta Ostensia yonder in Rome, the pyramid on the left, the old gate that you see there. This is the Forum, the Roman Forum, the ruins of it yonder in Rome. And someone says, well, they had free speech, didn't they? They had free speech if you said what the emperor wanted you to say. You could say anything you wanted to, long as he wrote your speech. And they did have a forum. And may I say to you that they established those forums over the empire. And I take you to the other end of the empire in this picture and show you yonder at Jerish, Jordan. This is a Roman forum that was established there. Rome left her trademark on this earth as no other nation has left her trademark, my beloved. And this is yonder at Caesarea. Caesarea was the place that Rome ruled Palestine. A great many people think, reading the Bible and not having other information, that probably Jerusalem. But Pilate, you see, was subject to others. And the center of Roman rule was Caesarea. And there you find the remains of a tremendous Roman civilization. This is a Roman denarius. This is the coin that Jesus asked for that day. On the right is the denarius that has Caesar Augustus picture on it, and the one on the left has Caesar Tiberius, and this was the denarius. You remember they asked whether they should pay taxes to Caesar or not? The Lord Jesus took this little coin on the right, one like it, and said, whose superscription is this? They said, it's Caesar's. He said, render unto Caesar that which is Caesar. You see, God had put this kingdom in this tremendous position. Lord Jesus never did denounce it. By the way, Paul never did denounce it. And yet, it was that empire that put him to death. And again, we return yonder to Caesarea. Another remain of the fact the Romans had been there, my beloved. And when the Romans had been there, you can always be sure they left their trademark. And again, this is that tremendous place, the Forum, yonder at Jerish, Jordan. And these are Roman columns that are at Byblos, Lebanon. Rome left her trademark, and you'll find them even today, my friend, in England, in Scotland, you'll find them in France and Spain, you'll find Rome's marks all over North Africa. Rome, my beloved, was a kingdom that crushed this world. Now I want you to move on, because I want us to follow the story according to the Scripture. In the 41st verse, "Whereas thou sawest the feet." Now, Daniel interprets this vision to Nebuchadnezzar. And when he got to this fourth one, he says, "Whereas thou sawest the feet and toes, part of potter's clay and part of iron, the kingdom shall be divided. But there shall be in it of the strength of the iron, far as much as thou sawest the iron mixed with miry clay." Now, this is the thing that interests me here, is the fact that there is introduced the clay, but the iron remains, and there's no fifth kingdom. There's a fourth kingdom. And my entire thesis tonight's going to be that Rome never died. Rome lives on. And Rome will only be destroyed in the way God says that it will be destroyed. Now, I want you to notice this clay, because I do not know how you feel about the clay. I used to think it was a pretty cheap sort of substance that was put in there and didn't amount to very much. Actually, we are told it's brittle, and it was like the clay used yonder in Babylon. This is one of the clay tablets that comes from the clay cylinders, rather, that comes from the time of Nebuchadnezzar II. And it's this kind of clay, the kind of clay you see here in these boundary stones that have been found at Babylon, made out of this clay. It's a very hard substance. And here you see these blue glazed brick. They've been found in Babylon. These, however, came from Old Ur of the Chaldees, even from the day of Abraham. And may I say, they're still intact, which reveals it was a very hard substance, yet it was very brittle. Now, the interesting thing about these, and as the toes of the feet were part of iron and part of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken. Now, that is the interesting thing, is that the iron represents strength, and the clay represents weakness, a fracture in the kingdom. And this is without doubt one of the most amazing things concerning Rome, for it was different. And it's different like this, my beloved. You're looking here at a slide that tells you something of the autocratic and democratic part of Rome. There was that autocratic like the iron, the democratic like the clay. There was the dictator on one side and the mob on the other. And the interesting thing is that the Roman emperors, they let themselves be elevated to the place of deity. Actually, Caesar Augustus, who became and was the emperor when Jesus was born. Actually, that was not his name at all. He took the name Caesar because he was an adopted son. He took the name of Augustus, and this is a good one. He took the name of Augustus because they suggested to him the name of emperor. He didn't think it was big enough. They suggested king. He didn't like that. And listen, they suggested to him dictator. He didn't like that, so they gave him the name of Augustus. And in that, you have the word augur, which is a religious word. They deified Caesar Augustus and worshipped him. And here you see the people actually burning incense and offering sacrifices to the Roman emperor. But the interesting thing is that the Roman emperor ruled because the mob let him rule. And there came a day when every Roman emperor who ruled with the rulership of a dictator, he had to provide circuses, and he had to provide grain for the immoral mob yonder in Rome and in the empire. The clay and the iron was there. They wouldn't mingle. It was the most unusual kingdom that's ever been on topside of this earth. And so Roman rulers lived in luxury, ruled like dictators, but always subject to the mob. That's interesting. My beloved, there's been no kingdom or government like that on the topside of this earth. Will you notice as Daniel continues interpreting, and whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of man. What does it mean, they? But they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. What he's talking here about they, he's talking about the emperors on one side and the mob on the other side. They'll never be able to mingle together, never be able to mix together at all. That's the statement that is made here. And may I say to you that you look at these emperors, they were some of them the most brutal and cruel and autocratic that have ever ruled. You're looking now at the column of Trajan yonder in Rome, and you read his story. It's a pretty brutal story. And that still stands as a monument to this man. But may I say, no man ever handed out grain and put so many people in a bread line. And no many man ever provided circuses. And no man ever let the public become debauched and depraved and immoral and drunken as this man did. He had to do it in order to rule. But he ruled like a dictator. Strange, isn't it? And stranger yet that Daniel should give that interpretation over 500 years before the man ever appeared. You're looking yonder at the Arch of Hadrian in Athens. And I said they put their trademark everywhere, and there it is, even in the cultured city of Athens. And as you look yonder at that arch, may I say that there's quite a story that's there, another emperor who rules so brutally. Now, my beloved, Christianity is tied into the history of Rome at this juncture. And I just want you to see this tonight for one reason, and that's to get more light on Rome. If you will notice there that Jerusalem was the center of the church, but the church wouldn't move out. And then God sent persecution. And Stephen was stoned to death. Then the church went out, my beloved, and when they went out, they went over this Roman Empire. Paul wrote to the Colossians and says, the gospel's been declared to you just like it is throughout the world. What he meant was the Roman world. It had gone throughout the world because those men were faithful yonder in those days. And when they carried the gospel out, a story started. Rome became afraid of the Christian. Small lot, weak group. But Gibbon says, Roman emperors were afraid of these strange people. And he has said, and other historians have repeated him, that the man who did more to destroy Rome was a little crippled Jew that hobbled into Rome around 65 A.D. His name was Paul the Apostle. He was in chains. But he was declaring a gospel that was going to shake the chains from the minds of men in that empire and make their souls free. Nero, a mad emperor, was afraid. And he set the city on fire. That's known today. He blamed it on the Christians. And the Christians, before the embers died out, had to flee that city. And persecution came upon the church. And it was brought by this nation of Rome. No Christian could talk back. Fox says there were probably, will you listen to this, 5 millions of martyrs. And that, my friend, is not preacher talk. Those happen to be accurate figures. Men and women laid down their lives for Jesus Christ. They were fed to the lions. They were put in the arena for the entertainment of the Romans, that debauched and depraved and drunken mob that the emperors were trying to keep in order they might keep in power. And then they went through a brief period of relaxation, but Domitian came to the throne, and when he did, The church had begun then to build little churches like this, not very imposing, but that's what they built, and then they started setting them on fire. The church went through that period. But the church, you see, believed the Scripture and believed this would be true. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. My beloved, and we're sure living in that kind of a day today. But the interesting thing happened, there came to the throne a Roman emperor, and his name was Constantine. Constantine said he had a dream like this. He saw a cross, and he went yonder to it, and he heard a voice say, "In hope, signa vinces." In this sign, conquer. And he became a Christian. I say a Christian. He did like a lot of people. He joined the church and went through a ceremony, but he never got converted. He forced 10,000 of his Roman soldiers to be baptized at the point of a sword. And believe me, brother, that's no way to baptize folk, at the point of a sword. But this man here, you can be sure of one thing, had his influence. And it changed the entire picture. This is the man, by the way, that divided the Roman Empire into the East and West. And it's interesting that that image should be so accurate in details. There are two legs of iron, East and West Roman Empire. And there is the arch of triumph of this man Constantine yonder in Rome. You want to see the detail there? We move in a little closer. Remember this arch. Because, you see, Rome never died, my beloved, and we'll see what we mean in just a moment. Now, I want you to notice this, that this Roman Empire now became friendly to Christianity. And before long, the church came into power, became ritualistic and adopted pagan customs. And before long, there was a clergy elevated to a high position. And yonder is St. Peter's in Rome. I won't go any farther in that direction tonight, but there is a tremendous story right there because that church is tied in to the Roman Empire when it comes back into power. And it's interesting that the first daylight air raid on Rome in World War II didn't drop any bombs on Rome. Therein hangs the tale. Berlin was destroyed, the headquarters of Hitler. Why wasn't the headquarters of Mussolini destroyed? And you can get that answer only in the State Department. Now, my friend, Rome never died. Rome fell apart. Rome was never destroyed. Gibbon says that Rome fell apart from within. That even the barbarian hordes that came in from the north, from Germany and from Russia, as they swept down into the empire, they never destroyed Rome. Attila came in there. Hun and burnt some, but he had no comprehension of this tremendous civilization at all, and he moved on. And may I say that Rome fell apart from within. And you're looking there in that circle at what was the Roman Empire at its height. And there came a day when it just fell apart, just like Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. It just fell apart, my beloved. And the interesting thing is this. Will you listen to this language? I'm quoting from Gibbon, who is still the greatest historian on Rome. "The empire of the Romans filled the world. And when the empire fell into the hands of a single person, the world became a safe and dreary prison for his enemies. To resist was fatal, and it was impossible to fly." And Dr. Robert Culver, who's written recently a very scholarly book on Daniel, says this, "Two millennia ago, that is 2,000 years ago, Rome gave the world the ecumenical unity which the League of Nations and the United Nations Organization have sought to revive in our time. The modern attempts are not original at all, as many of our contemporaries suppose, but are revivals of the ancient Roman ideal, which never since the time of Augustus Caesar has been wholly lost. Men from that day to the present hour have tried to revive what Rome did. And my friend, Rome made the United Nations work, but it was an awful prison house. And the Pax Romana, Roman peace. And as Dr. G. Campbell Morgan said, yes, Rome brought peace, and when Jesus was born, there wasn't war anywhere. You know what? He said not even a bird dared sheep unless it got permission from the emperor. That's the kind of peace that was brought in the world. And the world became a prison house. And that's what the United Nations wants to make. Did you know that if we actually get into this thing, that we'll have to surrender the Constitution of the United States, and if you commit a crime, you can be taken out of America and taken to Europe and tried? May I say to you, I can envision nothing tonight more horrible than a United States of Europe. And they talk about an Iron Curtain. The Word of God says it's going to be on this side of the Iron Curtain just like it is on the other side of the Iron Curtain. It was one time, 2,000 years ago, when Jesus was born. Rome brought peace in the world. Rome united the world. But Rome fell apart, for God says, the clay and the iron won't mix. And Rome fell apart. But don't you believe Rome died? I wonder if you've ever noticed that Gibbon entitled his history, The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire. What a chance he missed for alliteration, not to say the decline and destruction of the Roman Empire. But he didn't say that because Rome was not destroyed. Rome fell apart. And that's the thing that happened. And Rome lived on. I want to give you just a brief quotation from Dr. Hoffman, the great German historian. Will you listen to this? I never knew this until recently, that he'd made a statement like this concerning, and you're looking now yonder into the Louvre. The reason I wanted this picture, I thought when I got it, it would be a close-up yonder of that middle case, for in it is the sword of Charlemagne. And I want to read this to you. When Germans and Slavs advance partly into Roman ground, anyhow into the historical position of the Roman Empire, their princes intermarried with Roman families. Charlemagne was descended from a Roman house. Almost at the same time, the German Emperor Otho II and the Russian Grand Prince Vladimir intermarried with daughters of the East Roman Emperor. This was characteristic for the relations of the immigrating nations to Rome. Listen to Dr. Hoffman, who is one of the greatest German historians. They did not found a new kingdom, but continued the Roman. Rome never died, my beloved. Rome fell apart. And so it continues to the end of all earthly power until its final ramification into 10 kingdoms. To attempt now to mark out these would be misplaced as to fix the second coming of Christ. Now, my beloved, I want you to notice as we move along. This, by the way, is the castle of Heidelberg, where these emperors who were descended from Roman stock ruled, my beloved. And I move on down now, and as I move on down, I want you to see some of the kingdoms that are in existence today, and I'm not attempting tonight to identify 10 toes or 10 kingdoms or 10 horns, because I don't think you can do that, but I do think you can identify what fell apart in Rome. Here's Italy, if you please, and you're looking at a panorama view of the city of Rome, and we go over to the other side and get another view of the city. But this is the thing I'm interested to show you, is this balcony here, because they used to come out here, a big fat boy, that thought he could put the Roman Empire back together again. But you see, the little nursery rhyme says, all the king's horses and all the king's men
Can't put Humpty Dumpty back together again, including Mussolini. And he used to come to the balcony, but he doesn't come there anymore. Because it wasn't time for God to restore the Roman Empire, my beloved. And he never could have fulfilled the picture God gave in his word of the man that was to do it. Now yonder is Europe, and yonder are those kingdoms that are in existence today out of which Rome came. Let's move out of Italy, because Italy is only a very small part of it. We go over to Spain, and you're looking into the city of Madrid. I think it's well for us to just look at the peaceful countryside, but this nation, and this is the royal palace at Madrid, here is a nation that when America was discovered, the flag of Spain was raised first in the Western Hemisphere. Columbus sailed under the Spanish flag because Spain was the great nation of the world. And Spain tried her best to put Rome back together again. But Spain didn't succeed because it's not God's time. And isn't it interesting? In Italy tonight, they're too weak to put it together. In Spain tonight, they're too weak. Even the dictator in Spain tonight may be removed. Nothing but the Roman Catholic Church is keeping him in his position this evening because of the way Protestants are being kept down in that land. We move to France, and you will remember the story of France. In Julius Caesar, we read Omnia Gallii est divisa in tre parte. Boy, how I used to wrestle with that. All Gaul is divided into three parts. And yonder's Gaul. France was part of this Roman Empire. And I want you to look at France because it's quite interesting today. You're looking from the Eiffel Tower yonder to another triumphal arch. It's interesting how the Roman Empire's built them, and they've been building them all over the Roman Empire. This is the Seine River, and a beautiful view there. You're looking across the Place Concorde and the Champs-Élysées from the top of this tremendous triumphal arch that is there. And there it is. It was Napoleon's, by the way. Say a word about him in a minute, but you see, France wasn't able to rule the world. They tried to, but you see something happened. Germans entered Paris, but they left Paris and didn't stay. But Paris and France was not to rule, although there at Versailles Palace they attempted to institute the League of Nations. It didn't work. France had her kings and kings in the Roman line. And finally, they were taken to meet Madame Guillotine. And she took off the head. In fact, the last French king, he lost his head. The Republic was begun. And the man who almost succeeded in putting the Roman Empire back together again, he came closer than any other man, is the man who wore that hat. That's Napoleon's famous hat. And Napoleon almost succeeded. That's the throne he sat on. And this man was made the emperor. And he longed to put the Roman Empire back together again. God stopped him. God stopped him with a snowflake. He went to Warsaw, brushed the snowflakes away, and laughed. But those snowflakes and the snowstorm bogged this man down whose artillery moved so speedily. And then this man went to ignominy. And this is Napoleon's tomb. God wasn't ready for the Roman Empire to be put back together again. And we cross over to England. The British Isles were part of the Roman Empire. And England, my, how proud England was in the 19th century and at the turn of the 20th century. But two world wars have bankrupt England, and no longer does her proud navy sail the sea. That's looking Trafalgar Square, yonder in London. Great nation and a great civilization, and most of us either come directly or indirectly through the British Isles to this country.
And we owe a great deal to England. We owe a great deal to Great Britain. But may I say to your friends tonight how they failed and how they're unable to put them back together again. Someone else wanted to put the Roman Empire back together again. The Rhine River here was the boundary line that kept the barbarians out. The barbarians, by the way, were your ancestors and mine. And Rome wanted to keep them out because we were such crude people in those days. And they built along the Rhine River this series of fortresses. Didn't keep them out because they came in. They intermarried with the Romans. And yonder in Germany, there were three boys that they tried to put it back together again, and they didn't succeed. And this is Berlin. Yonder's the Reichstag, the ruins of it in the distance. And Berlin was bombed as no great capital city has ever been destroyed, probably, except Jerusalem by Nebuchadnezzar, my beloved. And you move to another capital. We go now to Vienna in Austria, and that's the Schloss of Schönbrunn. And again, here is the place where the Habsburgs, where the Hohenzollerns began, those who were in the line of the Holy Roman Empire. They tried to put it back together again. And wasn't long ago, a group of men met here in Geneva, Switzerland, and they tried to put them back together again. Mr. Dulles came back from the meeting of the foreign ministers, and he made this interesting statement. If we could only get 10 nations in Western Europe to come together, my friend, maybe God's not ready to put them back together again. And here is the world tonight. Many men are trying to put it back together again, but all the king's horses and all the king's men can't put Humpty Dumpty back together again. Rome lives on. Rome lives tonight. And what Rome is waiting for is for someone to come along and put the empire back together again. And may I say to you that they're looking for that man. If you doubt it, may I give you some quotations that I've gathered over a period of years. I have here one that goes back to 1940, and Premier Neville Chamberlain said he had only one hope of Europe. That was for a united Europe. It was a man from the University of Oklahoma, the great historian there, Dr. A.B. Sears, who after he returned in 1953 from Europe made this startling statement. He says, "It's been less than a decade since the close of World War II with all of its death and destruction, but already ample evidence exists that the peoples of Germany and even France are shopping around for the strong man. Europe's looking for him tonight." And it was Dr. Harold C. U. Ray, the scientist who worked on the first atomic bomb, who made this statement not long ago. "There is no constructive solution to the world's problems except eventually a world government capable of establishing law over the entire surface of the earth." And Mr. Reynaud, Paul Reynaud, one of the past premiers of France, and France has had 22 in the past 11 years, and his tremendous article in United States News back in 1953 was "A Coming United States of Europe." My beloved, may I say to you, God's Word says that it is coming. United States of Europe. What is the United States of Europe? Rome put back together again. The interesting thing is, this man Nebuchadnezzar, as he was yonder asleep and looked at this awe-inspiring vision, and as he looked, a stone cut out without hands smote this image. How will this kingdom end? God says that it's going to end like this. And some of our friends who tried to get rid of the premillennial coming of Christ, they call this a rolling stone, and it just gradually slips up on the image and
You sort of butts it two or three times, you know, before it tears it to pieces. That's not the picture in the book of Daniel. Will you notice as we go over yonder to the seventh chapter now, for I must turn there briefly for the details of how it's to end. After this I saw in the night visions, behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, strong exceedingly, had great iron teeth, and devoured and brake in pieces, stamped the residue with the feet of it. It was diverse from all the beasts that were before it. It had 10 horns. And that's the artist's conception of it. Rome, different, diverse. That beast, there's nothing like it. And that artist's conception is just as good as anybody else's. And that's as bad a dream as I'd want to have at night. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of man, and a mouth speaking great things. These 10 horns correspond to the 10 toes of the image of clay and of iron. The Roman Empire, if you please. And there comes up this one little horn. I'll go into detail concerning this on a Thursday night, but may I say to you that this little horn that comes up is Satan's man. He is the man of sin. And he comes into position. The 10 horns out of this kingdom of 10 kings, that shall arise, and another shall arise after them. He shall be diverse from the first, and he shall subdue 3 kingdoms. He shall speak great words against the Most High, shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws. And isn't it interesting that this committee of the United Nations is trying to come up with a new calendar, trying to get a world calendar and get world laws. They'll come up with them, but not until Satan's man comes along will God ever permit this to come to pass, my beloved. They shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time, which is probably the last 3.5 years of the great tribulation period. Now will you note, how will the kingdom end? I beheld till the thrones were cast down. The Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flames. And may I say that that's none other than the Lord Jesus Christ. 4 Gospels present him in all of his wonderful person and power. Matthew presents him as the king, and that's what he is in Daniel. And it is Mark who presents him as the servant, the ox. It's Luke who presents him as the man, and it's John who presents him as the Son of God. But my friend, he is the one who's King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's that stone cut out without hands, the stone that's coming to this earth and coming in cataclysmic and catastrophic power to establish God's kingdom upon this earth. And this poor, weary world will not get rid of war. And the best they can do will have a prison house like Rome had, until Jesus comes.